Well, good afternoon. After a very long morning, I finally landed in Texas. I'm now in San Antonio, heading my way to Fredericksburg. But first, I need to make a stop or two. First thing I need to do is eat food. Had nothing to eat all day, except for some almonds and some crackers on the airplane. Good news is, I've lost 2 hours of my day due to the time zone change, so it's only 11 a.m. So I've actually got some time back, and I'm looking forward to this weekend, and that is my lane drifting in the Toyota that I rented, even though I'm not drifting from lane, so that's going to be annoying. I figure why change things up? Let's grab another Toyota, because that's all I ever drive anyhow. Anywho, looking forward to this weekend. My first time in Texas, well, first time going to Texas intentionally. I've driven through the Panhandle twice. But I'm definitely looking forward to seeing Fredericksburg and San Antonio. Right now it's 80, no humidity, so it feels like a 70 Florida day to us. But everybody's going to talk about how hot it's going to get, so we will see. And while there's a Whataburger, don't need that. I've had a Whataburger before, wasn't impressed. Anywho, one of the keys to traveling is to try to find something that you don't have at home to eat. No reason to go all the way across the country and then stop at a Wendy's or Chick-fil-A or what have you. Once again, not a fan of Whataburger, so I will pass that one up. Anyway, I will check back with you guys soon. The problem with doing this is I have my Google Maps real small in the corner, and I have no idea where I'm at because I've never been to Texas. Anyway, just check in. I will talk to y'all soon. So I decided that I wasn't being fair to Whataburger. I haven't been there since like 1999 when I drove across country. It was like middle of nowhere, Texas. It was late. I thought, well, maybe they were just having a bad night. Maybe that was a shitty crew back in 1999. So I'm giving it a shot. French fries pretty good. Hamburger's not too bad. So I'll take back what I said about Whataburger a little bit. Not bad. Obviously not stellar food, but better than McDonald's. And once again, this is something that I can't get back home. So for at least for now, it checks off the items on the list. One, get some food in my belly. Two, find something I can't get home in Florida. And three, give them a second shot. So fries are very good. Hamburgers are big. I give it about a, I'll give it a C plus, maybe a B minus. I just want to put that out there. I'm not going to make you guys watch me eat. Anyhow, I will check in later. Take it easy.
Sailor, but before anybody says thank me or thank me for my service, please don't. I never wore the cloth. I never served in the military. I'm here as a character today. Now, I was an active duty classroom teacher for 31 years, and I taught American history.
Thank you, sir. I don't know about you guys, but I think this uniform is a little bit too clean. But we were the sleeping giant that most everyone was afraid would happen. Because not only do we have women and families rushing for the production and producing ships, jeeps, planes, and ammunition for the war front, but we also had thousands of women rushing to the recruiting offices to join the military in those positions that were vacated by the soldiers going to the war zone. Today, we have represented our Army nurse and our Navy nurse. Both the Army nurses and the Navy nurses, along with the Red Cross, were on the war front in the Pacific, serving on Corregidor and Bataan. And they would be some of the first POWs of World War II, which really brought their sacrifice close to American home.
My name is Gunnery Sergeant Warren Goodwin. I enlisted in 1917, joining the Allied Expeditionary Forces, going off to France to fight the campaign. At the Battle of Belle Woods, my first sergeant yelled to us, "Come on, who wants to live forever?" Well, after World War I, My first campaign was the Battle of Guadalcanal. One of my men screamed at me, "Hey, Packy, they're shooting at us." Well, I replied back, "Well, heck, what do you expect? You think he wants to kiss you?" Well, after Guadalcanal, they transferred me to the newly formed 3rd Marine Division, where I got to fight at the campaigns of Bougainville and Guam Island. After that, they said, "We want to send you to the rear." And I told them, "You can't do that. I just extended another 2 years. Give me one more campaign, just one more." Well, they gave me one more. On February 24th, while leading 2 Marine battalions on the attack on Matamoya Airfield, Gunnery Sergeant Warren Goodwin was shot by a sniper. He was evacuated to the hospital ship Solace. The following day, he died of his wounds. I am the United States Marine.
Basically, I'm holding a 1¼-pound bomb in my hand, but because of its appearance, it's known as pineapple. Now, you've all probably seen a movie where an actor taking a grenade, put that pin in his mouth, pulled the pin, threw that thing about 500 yards, and blew up a 10-story building. First big mistake they don't show you in Hollywood is that actor took this hand grenade, put his pin in his mouth and pulled it, and teeth should follow.
Hey everybody, and we are here at the National Museum for the Pacific War in Fredericksburg, Texas. Don't mind the get up. We've had two shows today out in the heat. Fantastic time. If you guys are ever in Fredericksburg, come out to the National Museum of the Pacific War, but also go down to the Pacific Battle Zone. I want to show you guys this. This thing is amazing. Feel free to pan this beautiful submarine. I say beautiful because it's an artifact, but it's very dangerous and scary. The history behind this, and I will let Jeff give you guys the history. Jeff Copsetta, he is the director of the Living History Program. If you've listened to the What's the Scuttlebutt podcast, you've heard Jeff on there twice now. So here he is, the man himself. Give us a little history on this vessel.
Yeah, sure. So this is a HA-19 Japanese mini sub. There were five mini subs that got into Pearl Harbor the morning of December 7th, 1941. This one was knocked out by a depth charge and knocked out the navigational equipment. So this one didn't quite make it into the harbor. The other four were destroyed throughout the attack, but this one was found beached not too far from the harbor. It was essentially POW number one of World War II. This traveled all across the country, helped raise war bonds for the first war bond drive. And if you get a close-up, you can see where when it traveled through the country, there were people that were etching their names in it, and messages, and things like that, as it went through places like Times Square and all the way down through California. So this is a very unique piece of history. It's just one of the many exhibits that we have here at the National Museum of the Pacific War. That's not something under glass. Kids can walk up and touch it. So it's a very special vessel, like you said, indeed.
Well, the crazy thing about this vessel is it's small and it only had a two-man crew. You had your captain and the one guy whose job was to fire the torpedoes. This thing had one job, and it was to get in, fire its fish, and get out undetected. Thankfully for us, this one didn't get in, less damage. And now the gunner did in fact pass away from the depth charge blast. The captain got out and was actually found on the beach and was captured. And as we all know, in the Empire of Japan, surrender, capture, anything other than dying for the emperor is shamed upon. And so he was unable to go home for many, many years because of the shame brought to his family by the fact that he did not die during his mission. I just wanted to do a quick video to point this out. Obviously, we're doing a video. We're in a static room. When you're here at the museum and you walk through this room, there'll be a countdown clock on the wall. Wait for it to count down to zero. There is a beautiful, well done, great production story behind this sub, the attack on Pearl Harbor. You got video displays on the wall, sound effects, lighting. This museum is amazing. And the thing that blew my mind, never been here, is we drive down the street, the footprint does not look that big. This place is huge. This is just one full-size artifact they have here. Planes, duck boats, I mean, tanks, tons and tons of vehicles. And real quick, the pass, when you come here, you buy the pass, it's good for 48 hours because you will not get through this place in one day if you're truly trying to educate yourself. It's the National Museum of the Pacific War, Fredericksburg, Texas. Check it out when you're here in Fredericksburg, San Antonio, wherever. When you're in Texas, just drive out here. You'll be happy you did. Try to schedule your visit with the Living History Program. They put on 7 to 8, depending on the season. Shows a year. I can't say enough about the Battle Zone. I was joking with Jeff. I said, you guys are kind of like the Universal Studios of Living History. The production that goes into their Living History Program, the pyrotechnics, everything. It's just mind-blowing. So get to Fredericksburg, get to Texas, check it out, you'll be happy you did. I want to share with you guys this beautiful property I was privileged enough to have offered to me. Not just to me, the other reenactors. I think there's one or two more staying there tonight. Al and his wife have this beautiful property called the Bella Vista Farms, and it overlooks beautiful Fredericksburg, Texas. And it just looks like we're on a country road right now, but it's when you actually get down this driveway that things change quickly, and it is a beautiful view. I'm heading back after our second event on Saturday. I'm going to go take a shower, and then we're all going to go out go downtown Fredericksburg, go to USO show, see the jazz band play, and have a good time. Good thing I rented a truck, by the way. Well, an SUV. And look at that. I'm pulling off the driveway here just so you guys can see that. What a beautiful view. Let's go look, shall we? Boom, there it is. I was expecting to be staying on a cot all weekend in a barracks with a bunch of smelly reenactors, and well, this happened. The trip's turned out to be pretty damn cool. Good evening, morning, whatever time it is. Just wrapping up the video. Some 17 and a half hours ago, I was waking up in Fredericksburg, Texas. Packed up all my stuff, drove down to the museum, participated in the evening program, quickly got changed, drove back to San Antone, hopped on a plane, flew to Atlanta, sat there for 3 hours, flew home. Little tip for those of you who live in Southwest Florida. If you go through the parking pay in line, through the credit card pay, don't go through it exactly midnight. Apparently there's a glitch. You'll pay for it, but the arm won't go up. You gotta hit the help button, and homeboy's gotta come out, and you gotta show him your bank account on your phone, showing that you did in fact pay. Anyhow, great trip. Thanks for sticking around through this whole trip, this whole video. And thanks for everybody for your continued support. I'm tired. Great time. Look forward to doing it again in the future. Not the near future, because I'm too damn tired. But yeah, tomorrow I got off for the holidays. And then 2 days from now, I'm driving to Kentucky. So that ought to be fun. But anyhow, that wraps up the trip to Fredericksburg, Tennessee, to the National Museum of the Pacific War. And getting the opportunity to participate in the Pacific battle zone. Anyhow, I'm just going to continue to mess this up because I need to get some sleep. I'm not even in my house yet. I'm opening the garage door now, then unpack all my gear, carry in my 49-pound suitcase, and get my sweaty, dirty P-41s out and lay them out in the garage so they don't turn all the rest of my stuff mildewy.
This has been a Digital 410 production.